श्रेया, आफ्टर लॉन्ग टाइम,
यस सर।
लास्ट ईयर इंटरव्यू लास्ट में था शुरू में था?
सर बिल्कुल शुरू में था, सेकंड डे ऑफ द इंटरव्यूज, 18th फरवरी।
अच्छा, वेयर यू कमिंग फ्रॉम राइट नाउ?
आई एम कमिंग फ्रॉम ऑफिस सर।
ऑफिस?
आई लास्ट ईयर आई गॉट सिलेक्टेड थ्रू टू द इंडियन ट्रेड सर्विस, सो आई हैव मिनिस्ट्री अटैचमेंट गोइंग ऑन राइट नाउ।
ओके, वेयर इज द ऑफिस?
उद्योग भवन, उद्योग
उद्योग
भवन,
भगवान. ऑल राइट, आई हर्ड उद्योग विहार एंड आई वाज लाइक उद्योग विहार
यस।
इज इन गुड़गांव फॉर द प्राइवेट सेक्टर. एनी वे, सो आई एम गोइंग टू आस्क यू कपल ऑफ क्वेश्चन आफ्टर विच वी कैन डिस्कस. सो श्रेया, कैन यू इंट्रोड्यूस योर सेल्फ टू मी?
So I'm Shreya Tyagi. I was born in Delhi and I've grown up in a few different places. My schooling, last years of schooling were from Kingdom of Bahrain in the Middle East, and I've done my college and post-graduation both in Delhi from DU and JNU. I am currently working in the Indian Trade Service in the Foreign Trade Europe Division. I come from a family of four, two sisters and my mother and father.
All
That's
right.
about it.
You stayed in Bahrain. Tell me, do you think that the United States is losing interest in Middle East and West Asia?
I don't think they're losing interest in West Asia. I think just new priorities are coming up, so they have to realign. I think they, through the course of history, they've also realized that there are limits to their actions in the Middle East and how much they personally can affect the outcomes of the regional dynamics. So I
What
guess there's
got
a
them
pivot.
interested in the Middle East in the first place?
First, it was oil, and
So
eventually.
don't you think now that the interest has reduced
Yes, sir, definitely.
under Donald Trump, President Donald Trump, where he said, "What are we doing in Middle East?" Right? He had this policy.
That's true.
Yes. So oil is one reason. Other is.
Sir, other is the fact that they have very strategic wishes for the Middle East. The fact that Israel is positioned there and is a key regional player means that the US is also keenly involved in the Middle East.
But what is distracting US from Middle East?
So the fact that China is emerging as a giant competitor to American interests worldwide, and now they have to concentrate on the Asia-Pacific region more. So I think the
As a
pivot to
child, I
Asia.
never heard of Asia Pacific. This looks like a very new invention, this term Asia Pacific.
Sir, Asia
No,
Pacific,
Asia Pacific, sorry.
Indo-Pacific.
Indo-Pacific, yes.
Yes, sir. Indo-Pacific is definitely a new vocabulary in I think American dictionary of IR. However, I think in our own IR dictionary, it was always there. We always saw the greater Indian Ocean as a part of stretching from, East Africa to the shores of Oceania and beyond. So I don't think it's necessarily a new invention for us. It's just a lot of the world powers are coming together on that idea of late. I would say that, sir.
USA wants us to join Quad, which we have done, Quad Security Summit. But there are equal number of arguments as to why we should not be a part of Quad. Can you tell me those arguments?
So it's seen as an anti-China instrument by the Chinese. It's seen as an Asian NATO by the Russians, and we have great strategic ties with the Russians in many areas, so we don't want to offend them. And it might be seen as a break in the strategic autonomy that has been a continuous foray of Indian foreign policy. So that could be, that are said to be some of the reasons as to why we shouldn't join the Quad.
There is yet another reason, something that is uniquely India's challenge that is not shared by those countries, by the other
Definitely,
members.
sir. Yes, sir. As you rightly said, the fact that China is our bordering country and none of these countries share a border with China puts us in a uniquely potentially aggressive position with China. And so definitely we might bear the brunt of those actions much more than the other three countries might.
Also, by joining the Quad, have we been able to get any concessions on the border dispute from the, so as to say, the world community or at least these nations?
So I think so. I think the Quad has been a fact of, I would say it's been a confidence building measure, especially with countries like Japan and Australia. Japan was one of the first countries to not condemn, but bring to notice, the world's notice about China's aggressions on the border. And I think we had a long-standing trust deficit with Australia in terms of how we want to build our military ties. So I think it has helped in that regard. Definitely, because you know, we can't be seen as aggressively anti-China or ganging up against it. It goes against the idea of what diplomacy is. I think there are limits to what the Quad can achieve. So I would say that's, I think it's been relevant in its own way.
You have a specialization in IR. Tell me, what is one primary concern of India with respect to American withdrawal from Afghanistan?
So one big concern that we have is that there is a security vacuum that is created, the results of which we are seeing right now with the Taliban violently trying to take power there. With the violent violent coming on of Taliban in Afghanistan, we can expect a rise in violence in the entire region, particularly in Kashmir. And I think that becomes a problem for us. I would say that is the major strategic challenge.
So if US withdraws from Afghanistan, we may have a scenario where the current government of Afghanistan is there in Kabul. The Taliban captures the rest of Afghanistan, a very likely scenario. In which case, engaging with any of them is not, both these governments lose legitimacy, right? So what sort of government would we want in Afghanistan?
So we want a democratically elected government, even if it is losing power in the rest of Afghanistan. I think it's not losing power as a form of loss of people support. It's losing power because...
But what if that democracy is concentrated just in Kabul and the rest of the regions are not represented? Then is there a point of speaking to such a government that is does not legitimately represent the whole of Afghanistan?
True, sir, that there is limits to how much power that they have on ground. However, I still think that it is still the more legitimate government versus the Taliban. The Taliban is not legitimate as such. It is more powerful and it is more strategic on ground, I would say.
So
and
should we speak to Taliban right now?
Yes, sir, because it is a key player in the future of Afghanistan and we have key assets that we need to guard. The potential threat of which are Taliban, we have to try to speak to them. However, what capacity we speak to them in, I think, is up for debate. However, I do think that as a country that has vital interests on ground, we need to be speaking to the Taliban as well.
So we want just a democratically elected government that represents Kabul, or we want a unity government that represents all of Afghanistan?
So we definitely would want a unity government that represents all of Afghanistan, similar to the grounds that emerged after 2001 and 2003. However, I think time awaits and we will see what exactly comes to power.
All right. It is said that the instability in Sri Lanka, or what is happening in Sri Lanka, is because of their political arrangement or the office, the way in which they have designed their political system, having the president and the prime minister. Can you explain it to me?
So the details of which I think I wouldn't know very well. I just know to the extent that these are, in a way that they come in conflict a lot. The power is distributed in a way that is not very systematic, which leads to
How
constant power
How is the Sri Lankan president different from the Indian president?
So there is considerable power that they have. As opposed to the Indian president, who is not directly making decisions on ground, there are significant powers.
Is the Sri Lankan president directly elected?
Sir, I think that's slipping from my mind. I think so, but I don't want.
If he were directly elected, how does it change his position?
Sir, if he was directly elected, definitely it comes from a position of popular legitimacy as opposed to the Indian president. And if someone comes from popular legitimacy, they are more likely to make their voice heard in a conflict. And
it is said that we are having presidentialization of a parliamentary system. In what way would you say that this is happening?
Sir, I think because of the fact that the parliament is losing its edge, I would say, in a few places, that bills are continuously being passed while adjournments are going on. Committees are not able to exercise the kind of power that they
Who
used to
do before. We elect in a parliamentary democracy as like ours? By
so
the
sorry.
Rule book, do we elect a prime minister or do we elect MPs?
We elect MPs, and then definitely individual powers of MPs, especially when they're not able to pass bills, or you know, it's just the majority that matters, then there is a threat to the system.
What contemporary English fiction have you read?
So recently I read the Rohinton Mystery has written this book called The Fine Balance. So I read it recently.
What is it about?
It is a story of convergence of four people, and it takes place in the backdrop of post-independence era through the emergency to the 1984 riots. So it's a story based on that, and how people in very different positions their stories meet, and how everybody is going through hardships in their own ways.
All that glisters is not gold. Which work or which novel am I talking about?
So if it's in reference to a particular one.
High intensity interval training. That is what you do, right? So this approach is a very Western approach, isn't it? So how does the Western fitness approach differ from the Japanese approach to good life and good health versus the Indian approach to good life and good health? Think and tell me the answer.
I think in terms of where the West is with fitness is a lot more body related, as in terms of how much you weigh, what you look like, etc. I think the Japanese approach focuses more on diet and health, and in terms of what you inhale is what you eat is what you are, and that kind of an idea. I think the Indian approach is more towards spirituality and a combination of all of these factors. So in yoga, you would have a combination rather than just a preference to one approach or the other.
All right. So because you do box fit, yoga and high intensity interval training, in terms of breathing, how does the Western approach differ from the Japanese and the Indian approach?
So I wouldn't know about the Japanese.
Okay.
And but there is a substantial difference that I know between the West and the Indian approach. The fact is that in the Indian approach, the breath is a life force, and it has to be inhaled in a way as to give you power. It's not just a mechanics of the body. So I think that's where it differs majorly, that it's seen as a way to. So in a lot of fitness movements, in yoga, you would have the exhale and the inhale aligned to those movements. Those are not necessarily a part of, say, box fit or HIIT. And I think that's where they substantially differentiate from one another.
The duration of the breath?
Duration of the breath, sir, definitely is longer in the Indian systems of fitness. There is an insistence on, four breath in, holding it and then releasing it, rather than inhale and out. Exhale approach in the West.
Fast breathing will happen in any fitness regime of the West.
Yes.
In Indian, the healthier, the deeper the breath is, the healthier it is.
Yes.
The Japanese are somewhere in between. They prefer mild cardio, slow jogging, cycling, walking.
Okay.
They think them as the, so they will be somewhere in between, right? In India, we think that we have X number of breaths, so we should do slow breathing and long breathing, right?
Okay.
In the West, all right, very good. What is the current trade imbalance that we have with China, Shreya?
Sir, close to 40 billion.
How can we bridge these gaps?
So the major gaps that we have with China exist in the fact that we don't have sufficient market entry in their markets. They have created a lot of non-tariff barriers that exist for entry of our products. Second, sir, we have very competitive market advantages, and in terms of what we are putting out in the market. So a lot of what we are able to put out in the market is not necessarily what the Chinese want. And this is something that the Indian...
Can you give some examples as to on some of what products of ours they have put tariff and non-tariff barrier or non-tariff barriers?
Sir, a lot of dairy and food items are substantially taxed in China in terms of tariff barriers. And there are a lot of non-tariff barriers, that is phytosanitary measures that are imposed. If I was to give an example, something like the import of bovine meat, there is a lot of restriction that the Chinese put that are not equivalent to the kind of barriers that they put on other Southeast Asian countries. So we have to bear the brunt of those, and we have repeatedly flagged it to China. It seems to be a matter of great concern.
China is way ahead of us in manufacturing, and we already have a major manufacturing player. Agriculture is no more remunerative. Where will India's growth come from? And where will we employ so many people?
So it has to be in the transitionary sectors. So in terms of from agriculture, we have to utilize that manpower to food processing and similar sectors. I think we have a huge market because we have lots of raw material. They need to be utilized in those kind of markets. And second, sir, we have to look at labor intensive markets like textile. And these need to be the forays and through which more people are employed.
But even if you take textiles, there is enough mechanization, right? And if you involve human labor, it raises the cost, making it non-competitive, isn't it?
Not necessarily, because the thing is, if we look at smaller scale markets that have been created all over the world in terms of Bangladesh or Vietnam, they have utilized their extra workforce in smaller scale industries. Of course, the big industries that are powering through and, you know, hold a majority of their export potential may be concentrated in bigger industries. But employing wise, there are many small scale industries in textiles in both Vietnam and Bangladesh that are employing a substantial number of people and helping those people come out of poverty.
Bangladesh is doing well on the economic front. Should we have any concerns?
I don't think so. I think it's a good thing if our neighborhood is prospering, especially the neighborhood with which we have complicated ties. I think the more that Bangladesh develops, there is less a chance of it tilting towards extremism and more chance of it being an engine of growth even for our northeast and surrounding areas.
And what opportunities does it offer us?
Sir, if Bangladesh improves in a lot of industries, there is sufficient capacity for us to build off a strong supply chain from Bangladesh in terms of, say, textiles. If there are smaller scale industries, we can process it further and sell it to bigger markets.
Shreya, it is said that India does not have an unemployment problem, it has a wage problem. Can you explain?
Yes, sir. I would say the wage problem comes from the fact that our labor codes are not anymore, but they were sufficiently complicated, which makes it difficult for people to employ on a contract basis. Because of that, I think
India does not have an unemployment problem, it has a wages problem.
I can't understand how you wouldn't have an unemployment problem. I think the statement is somehow not.
No, we have jobs. Really. This statement is trying to say that we have jobs, just that the jobs do not pay well enough. Right. So what kind of jobs are we creating?
The jobs that I think we are creating are either blue collar or white collar jobs, and white collar jobs are very concentrated at the top, very few in number. The middle that needs to be bridged, I think, is something that is not being created sufficiently. And that's where I would say maybe the wage problem comes in. The fact that either you're earning very well or you're earning very less, and there's a great inequality that's then being created.
So you are already Assistant Director General of Foreign Trade.
Yes.
All right. We are not currently doing well on the trade front. Why are you so unhappy? Why you want to join the IAS?
I think we're doing sufficiently fine on the trade front. We can definitely do better. This quarter was actually much better than our last 3 years at this position combined. Why I want to upgrade my service, I'm always, since I think I'm...
So you want to upgrade your service? Is that really a hierarchy?
No, sir, to foreign service. I want to go for the foreign service. Upgrade was the wrong word, sorry, sir. I want to go for the foreign service, sir, because that's why I actually started preparing for the civil services. And I think that is where the majority of my interest lies. And so I do want to try as far as I can towards that aim.
All right, Shreya, your interview is over.
Thank you so much.